Good afternoon and welcome to the Asian Midday Market Watch. Our guest today is David Kuo, founder of the Smart Investor in Singapore. David, as always, great to have you on the show.
Ah, thank you so much, Brian. And are we going to be talking about Chelsea winning the Champions League or not today?
Well, you know, not really, especially because I'm a Liverpool fan, but I think you've got a very good team right now.
I think we have got a very good team. I'm going to be going and collecting my Champions League medal, by the way. But the medal being able to stay up at 3 o'clock in the morning for 2 hours watching the, listening to the game.
Yeah, I was very surprised that Man City lost that. I thought Man City would have that covered quite easily.
Well, to be honest with you, I wasn't expecting to win either. But I think Pep Guardiola went all out for a win and Chelsea were a good match for them. And our defense was very strong. So,
absolutely. Anyway. Now, before I get your insights, I'm going to take a look at how markets in the region are performing. And we're going to start with cryptocurrency. Now, Bitcoin is at 36,700. It's up on a 24-hour basis, about 6.64%. But the big mover is actually Ethereum, which is up 14.48% at 2,637.03. Now, U.S. markets were closed overnight for public holidays, so you're going to have less of an impact on local exchanges or regional exchanges, rather. We'll start with the SGX, which is the Straits Times Index, is at 3,166.95. It's up 0.08%. Bursa Malaysia's FBM KLCI is at 1,580.67. Now, it's down 0.18%. Now, across the region, we've got the Nikkei, which is down 0.4% at 28,745.36. Shanghai Composite is at 3,611.33. It's down 0.11%. The Hang Seng is at 29,275.77. It's up 0.43%. ASX 200 is at 7,147.4. It's down 0.2%. Rounding up the numbers, we've got the KOSPI, which is up 0.52% at 3,220.48. So what do you make of the markets, which are very mixed across the region, David?
Well, I don't think the word is mixed, Brian. I think it's all over the place at the moment. And I think people are just looking for some kind of guidance. And I think the guidance may come later on when we get the non-farm payrolls at the end of this week. The numbers being handed around are roughly about 600,000 new jobs being created. So that will put
David,
some pressure
last,
on
the last time the numbers were missed horrendously. So I suppose the markets are also looking for a direction in terms of, was that an anomaly or perhaps that's a trend?
Well, or maybe that the job numbers are going to play catch up. So maybe the last set of numbers were so far out that what we're going to be getting this time is some catch-up numbers. So, I mean, that is why that figure of about 600,000 is being put about. But ultimately, what it really means is that if those numbers do come out, Brian, it will put some pressure on the Federal Reserve, because it will mean that jobs are being created, and at the same time, you've got some inflationary pressures in the in the U.S. economy, and the economy seems to be growing quite well. So, what is the Federal Reserve going to do? I mean, what is Jay Powell going to do, given those numbers that he's got? Because what he said all along is that his concern was about unemployment. And if the jobs are being created, that kind of sort of puts that to the back burner. And then he'll have to address the more immediate issues, such as inflation.
But there are other central banks, David, on the other flip side of the equation. Other central banks are already making their moves. So Korea and New Zealand are telegraphing that the end of stimulus and low interest rates are probably coming to an end. Now, what's your view on this? Is this the canary in the coal mine that's a signal to other central banks they're going to be following suit?
Well, apart from those two central banks, Brian, you can also add in the Canadian Central Bank and also the Bank of England. I mean, they've also said that it is about time that they start withdrawing some of that stimulus, because they can see a lot of activity going on in their own economies. They can see asset prices going up, and they are not unaware of inflation rising as well. So they've got three problems. The economies are growing, asset prices are quite high, and also at the same time, they've got inflation. So they're probably saying that enough is enough. They've already cut interest rates low enough. They've already bought enough bonds at the moment. There's sufficient liquidity in their own economies, and maybe it is time to start scaling back a little. But as far as investors are concerned, we should never have expected interest rates to be at zero forever. And so consequently, we have to be prepared for the fact that interest rates are going to rise at some point, Brian, and you need to have a look at your portfolio and be aware that, yes, there is going to be probably some slight inflation. And the good part is that the economies are growing, which is probably why prices, consumer prices are rising. So, I mean, those are three really positives for the global economy. And I don't think, well, If you were a borrower in the past, and if you were a homeowner and you had interest rates that were relatively low, I would have hoped that you would have taken the opportunity to repay as much of your mortgage as possible, because I can't see interest rates being this low forever, Brian.
Yeah. Now, closer to home, though, there's just been a new stimulus package in Malaysia. 40 billion ringgit was announced yesterday, and Malaysia starts lockdown today. What's your view on Malaysia overall?
Well, I think it is a warning for all economies around the world, Brian, that this virus is pretty sneaky. And what we need to remember about the virus is that the moment you take your eye off the ball, which is really what Man City did against Chelsea, they took their eye off the ball and then they got hammered, right? 1-0. Yeah. So I think you cannot afford to take your eye off the ball. What we've learned throughout the whole of 2020 and for the first 6 months of 2021 is that you have to get people vaccinated. You have to watch for the virus coming back. The moment you see it coming back, you have to step on it, really. In other words, you have to lock down and you have to isolate people. And people in general need to go around with a mask on. If you do those things, then there is a good chance that you don't need to lock down your economy. But if you don't do those three things, then of course, you have to lock it down. And you go back to that old phrase, no pain, no gain. In other words, you have to suffer some pain. We in Singapore have been in circuit breaker for 2 weeks already, and we probably have another 2 weeks to go. But you make a very valid point. The government has to step in with some kind of stimulus in order to try and help people out, because you can't just lock them in and say, I'm not going to give you anything back in return. Yep. You have to say to them, we have your backs. We have to try and sort of help you out as much as possible. Whether 40 billion is enough is kind of arguable. Some people may say you need a lot more because you have a lot more people over in Malaysia than we do here in Singapore.
Now, David, where are the opportunities for in the Malaysian market now for investors?
Well, the thing is, I mean, there's been a pretty big sell-off in the Malaysian market. So I run this a portfolio for the people at Smart Investor. It's called the Malaysia Money Machines, and it contains 20 stocks. And I have a look at those companies within the 20. Now, mm-hmm. Some of them are doing pretty well. If you have a look at, say, the brewers, I mean, Heineken and Carlsberg, they're doing okay. If you have a look at some of the food ingredients makers like Ajinomoto, they're doing okay. Panasonic seems to be doing okay. Obviously, the REITs aren't doing as great as I would have liked. So they're a bit of a drag on the portfolio. But the banks look pretty strong at the moment. And then yep. You also have a look at another one of my favorite stocks there, Westports Holdings. I mean, that seems to be doing okay because Malaysia seems to be exporting quite a lot of stuff. So in general, I think the portfolio is not as great as I would have expected it to be by now, but you just have to take the good times with the bad. And at the moment, we're going through a pretty rough period. And hopefully, once you release your lockdown, the economy will start moving again. And then these other companies will be able to grow. So I see a lot of opportunities in Malaysia. Just close your eyes, take a pin out, and then just stick your pin in any company. And I think you'll find it's pretty cheap.
Now, David, thank you very much for your insights.
Thank you.
Now, we've been speaking to David Kuo, the founder of the Smart Investor in Singapore, on BizTax Asian Midday Market Watch. I'm Brian Fernandez. Please check out our LinkedIn and Facebook pages, as well as our website, www.biztech.asia. Thanks a lot for tuning in.